Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to this session on finance and banking important terms. So today we are going to discuss some more finance and banking important terms, and this session is going to be certainly very long, and at the same time we'll have some future sessions as well on the same. We'll be talking about important terms of finance and banking. The reason that I'm covering all these important points before starting with the actual finance is because, number one, a lot of questions do come directly from these important terms. So no matter how much in depth you have studied, if you have not covered the breadth of finance, you might end up losing out a lot. And secondly, whatever you will be covering in the future in further sessions, these understanding of these important terms is going to be very helpful to you. Okay, so it certainly will simplify a lot of things for you, especially a lot of you are from non-finance background, so this is going to take care of those issues. Okay, so we'll be using this table of contents directly instead of using the entire document. You can use this document in order to study later as well, but right now focus on what I'm going to tell you about these various important terms. Remember that a lot of these terms have been explained in detail in these documents, providing a lot of provisions, a lot of important things about these terms. But in this video, I'm going to just focus on the concept behind these terms, okay? Not focusing on the provisions, because that we'll be going through at a later stage as well. So the first term that we have identified is small finance bank and payment banks. Now, what exactly is the concept of this and what are these banks? There are two categories of banks: universal banks, number one, and then there are narrow banks. Narrow banks, also called as niche banks, also called as differentiated banks. One and the same thing, differentiated banks. These are one and the same thing. Now, all these narrow banks, niche banks, or differentiated banks are one of small finance bank and payment banks. So payment banks and small finance bank is a new class of narrow or niche or differentiated banking, the focus of which is, as the name suggests, is to focus on a narrow class of citizens, is to focus on a small set of people. Whereas the focus of universal banks is to try to do everything, number one, and at the same time to try and focus on as many people as possible. Whereas small banks, payment banks, do a small set of things, do not have a lot of activities, small set of activities, as well as small set of people being targeted. Okay. Now, how are they different from each other? They are very similar in a lot of aspects. The main difference is that payment banks focus only on receiving funds. So they're not allowed to lend. Therefore, whatever funds they receive is very safe. Whereas small finance banks can receive funds just like payment banks, but whatever deposits they get, they can also lend it in the local area so that people move away from, or people are rid of, unorganized borrowing and lending. For example, money lenders. In older movies, you might have seen that money lenders are very exploitative in nature. Now, in order to remove them from the society, in order to remove their exploitation from the society, we are creating one set of banks called as small finance banks. Let's go through them one by one and see if whatever we have understood is correct or not. Small finance bank, the purpose or the objective is to further financial inclusion through provision of saving vehicles. Number one, saving vehicles, which means accepting deposits, and supply of credit to small entities. And payment banks, they can only accept deposits, they cannot lend the money further in the market. Okay, now there are a lot of provisions here: eligible promoters who can become a promoter of small finance bank and payment bank, scope of activity that I've just explained, promoter, how much has the promoter to contribute, what are the first payment banks and first small finance bank, what are the CRR SLR requirements, what are priority sector lending norms, where can they deploy funds, capital requirement, etc., etc. There are a lot of similarities also, but we're not going to go into them because the purpose of this session is very clear, only to focus on the concepts. The next is twin balance sheet problem. What exactly is twin balance sheet problem. Let's understand what is twin balance sheet problem. Let me see if I can remove the entire thing in one go. Okay, I have it. Okay, what is twin balance sheet problem? So twin balance sheet problem, the second one. Okay, twin balance sheet problem. Twin means two balance sheets are involved. What are these two balance sheets? Number one, we have the balance sheet of corporate houses or companies. Okay, balance sheet of corporates. And number two, we have the balance sheet of banks. So we have two balance sheets here, balance sheets of corporates and balance sheets of banks. Now, how are these two balance sheets involved in this problem? So what happened? The cycle starts from banks lending money to these corporate houses. So banks lend money to these corporate houses. Now these corporate houses have a lot of money at their disposal and they are required to invest it. Let's say this is a real estate company. Let's say something like Amrapali. Okay, so Amrapali has taken a lot of funds from the banks in order to create some houses in the market, in order to construct. It does construct a lot of houses. Market is going down. It is not able to sell as many houses as it has constructed. It has constructed thousands and thousands of houses in these huge buildings that have been created, but it is not able to sell all of them. People are not willing to buy. Demand is low. So money is stuck. Money is lying idle here because this money has been used to construct these houses, but now these houses are not selling. They're just lying idle. So it is not able to pay back the loan to these banks. Not able to pay back the loan to these banks. Remember, the corporates have taken loan from these banks. This money is not for free. So what happens is, now the balance sheet of corporate houses is stressed because they've taken a lot of loan from these banks and they have to pay a lot of interest on these loans. But because their earnings are nil or very low, they're neither able to pay back the loan nor they're able to pay back the interest on these loans. And how are banks affected? Banks are affected because they had given this money to these banks. This money belongs to the people because it is out of deposits. You and I, people like us, have made deposits in these banks. These deposits have been used as loans forwarded to these companies. Now these companies are not able to pay back these loans to the banks. And therefore, these banks have to make provisions because now they fear that these loans might go bad. These loans might never return. Therefore, they have to increase their bad debts or provisions for bad debts. And that affects their balance sheet. That reduces the capacity of these banks to lend further. That affects the asset side of their balance sheet directly. So, the corporates are affected. In the corporates, the liability side of balance sheet is affected. Why? Because they have a liability towards these banks to pay back these loans. Loans come in liability side of balance sheet and they're not able to do it. They're not able to pay back. Whereas in banks, the asset side is affected. Why? Because these loans which have been given forwarded, which have been forwarded by these banks to these corporates, are assets of these banks. And now these assets are not coming back. So these assets are affected. Okay, so this is entire twin balance sheet problem. I hope you have understood it. Let's come to the next term. What is the next term? Instead of going through all this, you can go through all this yourself as well. It's nicely placed there. Linking interest rate to external benchmark. We need to understand what exactly is monetary policy transmission here, as I have written here. You can go through this as well. But monetary policy transmission, what exactly is monetary policy transmission? Let's understand that very briefly and then we'll come to external benchmarking of interest rates. So what is monetary policy transmission? Let's say this is the Reserve Bank. Okay, this is the Reserve Bank. And now this Reserve Bank, through its monetary policy, uses its monetary policy in order to change its repo rate and reverse repo rate. Okay, now let's say it reduced its repo and reverse repo, let's say repo only, from 6 to 5.5%. Okay, now this repo rate is used by banks. Let's say this is a small bank. Now this repo rate is going to be used by banks in order to lend in the market and borrow from the market, because all the rates are linked to these repo rates. However, the bank which was charging 10% before, Now, instead of charging 9.5%, because if it reduces by 0.5%, the rate of bank should also reduce by 0.5. But instead of that, it charges 9.9%. So the impact is not 100%. Here the reduction is 0.5%, and RBI says we have reduced it by 0.5. You also reduce it by 0.5, or at least something nearer to 0.5. But the bank, through its own formula or through anything else, reduces it by only 0.1%. So it means that the monetary policy transmission, the transmission of monetary policy is imperfect. The transmission of monetary policy is imperfect in this case. Okay. And that is where external benchmarking comes into play. Now, there are a lot of terms here. First is BPLR. Next is base rate, which was introduced in 2010. Then came MCLR. Okay. Now, these are all methods of identifying how banks, charge interest rates from people. What exact method should be used by banks in order to identify what interest rate should be charged from people. In base rate is what it was different, in BPLR it was different, in MCLR it was much more refined. So we are moving towards more refinement. I'm not getting into the technicalities because I've explained them when we go forward with the course. Okay, this is something else. But with the MCLR, what is happening is there is internal benchmarking. What is internal benchmarking? Internal benchmarking means that banks have the ability to charge higher interest rates if they can show that their internal costs of borrowing, because they are also borrowing from somewhere in order to lend, if they can prove that their internal cost of borrowing or cost of operations or different internal costs are still high, they don't need to reduce these rates. And because of this internal benchmarking, internal means internal costs of banks, benchmarking means targeting, connecting one thing to the other. So the bank says I can only reduce it by 0.1% to 9.9 because my benchmark is cost of borrowing, my benchmark is operations, cost of operations, which are still very high. Therefore, instead of reducing it by 0.5, I can reduce it only by 0.1%. Now, RBI says, let us have external benchmarking. RBI will tell these banks what are the different benchmarks which can be used by banks. So RBI says, okay, instead of cost of operations, you take average of cost of operations of these five banks. Okay, average of cost of operations of these 5 banks or these 10 banks. That way, you are externally benchmarking it. No matter, let's say your cost of operation might be 100 rupees per loan. Okay, for every loan, for example. Whereas the average of the top 5 banks or average of a group of 10 banks might be only 60 rupees. So instead of taking 100, now you are allowed to take your cost as only 60. That way, because of external benchmarking, your monetary policy transmission will be much better. It will be much better. Why? Because now you are benchmarked to an external rate. So you cannot hike your cost and try and fool RBI by saying that because our costs are high, therefore our interest rates cannot go down. Okay, now that cannot happen. Okay, so this is about external and internal benchmarking and how RBI is pushing banks to move towards external benchmarking based on MCLR from internal benchmarking based on MCLR, which is the present policy of banks. Okay, I hope you have understood it. Let's move towards next. So BPLR, base rate, MCLR, they have been explained here. They've also been explained when I talk about monetary policy transmission in Indian banking system. No need to worry about that. Okay, what is negative interest rate? Let's talk about negative interest rate. Very interesting. Negative interest rate, NIR. So interest rate is what amount of interest you have to pay if you borrow, or what amount of interest do you get if you lend. Let's say today I go to a bank and I say I want to deposit 1 lakh rupees. This is my yearly savings. The bank says, I will give you 6% interest rate per year on this deposit. That means I will get 6,000 as interest on this deposit per year. Let's say interest is per annum and it is simple interest. Okay. Now let's say instead of being in India, I am in Japan, which follows negative interest rate policy. What will happen? A person in Japan goes to a bank, deposits 1 lakh rupees, but the bank says, I will give you minus 1% as interest. That means after 1 year, I will charge 1000 rupees interest. That means after 1 year, I will not ask you to give me 1000. Your deposit in the account will reduce to 99,000 instead of being 1 lakh. Okay, so this is how negative interest rate works. And in case of borrowing, what will happen? I go to a bank in India. I am in India here and I am in Japan at the lower position. I go to borrow. I say I want to borrow 1 lakh rupees to start my own business. The bank says I will charge 10% interest. So 1 lakh I will give you, but after 1 year you have to pay me 10,000 as interest. So this is interest that this person has to pay to the bank. In Japan, what will happen? I go and borrow from the bank. The bank says, okay, I will give you 1 lakh rupees, but I will charge an interest rate of, let's say, minus 1%. Again, the same here, minus, or let's say minus 2% to make it easier. That means I will give you 2000 rupees as interest after 1 year, which means you have to pay me. You in any case have to pay me this 1 lakh rupees as which is the principal that I have given you, but 2000 I will give you after 1 year because we have negative interest rate policy. So net you have to pay me only 98,000 after 1 year. Okay, so what it is doing here, it is incentivizing people to borrow and invest, but at the same time it is also incentivizing people not to lend to these banks. That is where the problem lies. Therefore, it is an unconventional policy which is followed by banks in extreme circumstances when they want to kickstart the economy by incentivizing people to invest money, to borrow and invest. Borrow, consume, invest, do whatever you want to do with the money, but don't keep it in your pockets, or do not be minimalist. Be materialist in nature. That is the idea. Because if you don't start consuming, if you don't start investing, then suppliers will not produce. Why will I teach if nobody is interested in studying? Similarly, why will a producer produce if nobody is interested in eating? Okay. So in order to kickstart the economy, negative interest rate policy is followed as one of the last resorts. I hope you have understood what is negative interest rate policy. Equalization levy, very important. What exactly is equalization levy? Let me write here EL. So what happens is in equalization levy, it's a European concept which says, started in Europe, which says that, okay, Google is an American company, Facebook is an American company. What these companies are doing, they are charging a lot of money for advertising. Okay, on Facebook and Google, you see all day long advertisements everywhere. Everybody is advertising on Google and Facebook. Companies are advertising on Google and Facebook. NGOs are advertising on Google and Facebook. All these companies are paying to Google and Facebook. Okay, let's say I advertise in 1 year, I advertise for an amount of rupees 1 lakh. Okay, that is my investment or expenditure on advertisement with Google. So Google says, because we are a US based company, we are not an Indian company, so this entire amount of 1 lakh will go to the US directly. And the Indian government says, what have we got here? Everything is happening in India. The person who is advertising is an Indian citizen, Indian company holder. He's advertising with Google. Google is advertising in India. Indian consumers are consuming because of that. But out of this, all this cyclical business activity, whatever money is being generated by Google, that is going away. And we are not getting any tax on it. That is the central idea. We are not getting any tax on it. So the government says, you pay us an equalization levy. Okay. It was introduced in India in 2016 with the intention of taxing digital transactions, as is mentioned here. the income accruing to foreign e-commerce companies from India. So whatever income accrues to foreign e-commerce companies, they have to pay an equalization levy. It started with 6%, okay? 6% of the gross consideration to be paid. I hope you've understood it. Let's come to the next one. Credit deposit ratio. What exactly is this? It means how much of a bank's funds are being used for lending. Let's say a bank receives, so this is a bank, total core funds, let's say deposits, fixed deposits, saving deposits, time deposits, all kinds of deposits and every kind of deposit that a bank receives, funds that a bank receives, let's say is rupees 100 per year. One bank is able to lend, let's say 40 rupees out of this 100 rupees, and 60 rupees it is not able to lend because of governmental restrictions. And another bank which is in another country is able to lend, let's say 70 rupees out of this. 70 rupees is lent here, 40 rupees is lent there, and it is not able to lend, only 30 rupees. Now because this 30 rupees is not lent, 60 rupees is not lent, there is no income. But there is an income generated from this. Okay. Now the second bank is going to do much better. Bank 2 is going to do much better because it is able to generate income out of 70 rupees. Whereas bank 1 will not be so successful because it is able to generate income only out of 40 rupees of rupees 100 deposits that it receives. So credit deposit ratio is out of all the credit that you have received, how much are you able to forward as lending? That is the credit deposit ratio. Guaranteed loan. Whenever, let's say you go to the bank and you ask for a loan, the bank says, who is your guarantor? The bank says, okay, I will give you a loan of 10 lakh. What guarantee do I have that you will pay back this 10 lakh rupees to me? Okay, so you say, okay, my dad is the guarantor here. He has a successful business and he's going to pay back if I don't pay back. The bank says, okay, your dad has a good business. He has a lot of deposits. So we're going to make him as your guarantor. And if you don't pay, we will seize his accounts. So we have the child here, we have the dad here, and we have the bank here. Okay, so the child goes to the bank, says, I need 10 lakh rupees to start my business. Bank says, what is the guarantee? What is the guarantee that you will pay back? The child says, my dad has a business which has a market value of, let's say, 5 crore. Okay, or he says, my dad has fixed deposits worth 50 lakh. Okay, 50 lakh worth of fixed deposits. So the bank says, okay, if you don't pay back this 10 lakh rupees, we are going to seize this 50 lakh rupees FD that the bank, that your dad has, and we will take 10 lakh out of this. Okay, and we will also take whatever interest you don't pay, in case you don't pay any interest. The child says, okay, it is fine. The dad says, okay, it is fine with me. I believe my child. So the dad here is acting like a guarantor here. And this is a guarantee-based lending or guaranteed loan because it has been guaranteed. Multi-currency basket. What happens is, the best example is special drawing rights of IMF. Now, special drawing rights is an international reserve asset created by IMF. Mind my words, it's not a currency, it's an international reserve asset. So SDR, how do you determine what is the value of one SDR? So there are total of five currencies. There are total of five currencies which are going to be used. So what is a, let me explain to you how exactly does it work. So SDR has a multi-currency basket. So this is the basket that SDR has. Based on this basket, the value of SDR is going to be determined. So when SDR, this is the basket, it has yen, it has euro, it has dollar, it has renminbi, and there is one more. Yen, dollar, renminbi, euro, and there is one more. I don't remember it. Okay, it doesn't matter. So SDR is a combination of five currencies. Now what happens is, whatever the value of these five currencies is in the market today, let's say one US dollar is equal to 70 rupees. That is the value of dollar in the market today vis-a-vis rupees. 1 yen is equal to, let's say, 1 rupee. 1 euro is, let's say, equal to 80 rupees. Okay. 1 renminbi, I don't know what the sign is equal to, let's say, for 4 rupees. Okay. This way, we determine the value of all these vis-a-vis one basic currency, and then we create the average. And based on this average, the value of SDR is going to be determined. So what happens? Whatever fluctuations dollar is receiving vis-a-vis rupee, whatever fluctuations yen is experiencing, whatever fluctuations euro is experiencing, all those are averaged out because now we are using 5 currencies. So this is called as multi-currency basket. Next is human capital contract. What is a human capital contract? Very easy to understand. You are a student, you want to go and take a loan for education. A lot of you might have taken loans for education purposes. What happens when you take a loan? You take a loan, let's say 25 lakh rupees for the next 2 years for an MBA, after which you have to start paying. So the loan amount is 25 lakh rupees. It is for 2 years. This means for 2 years you don't have to pay anything. Then there is a moratorium of, let's say, 3 years, which means for the next 3 years, because they want you to settle down, you don't have to pay anything. After 2 + 3, 5 years, you start paying an interest of, let's say, 10% plus a principal amount of, let's say, 2 lakh per year. This is how much you have to pay. Okay, this is a normal loan. In case of human capital contract, what they say is you don't pay us anything for these 2 years. In these 3 years, there is no moratorium. So what happens is, as soon as you start working, let's say you get a job of 10 lakh per annum. You get a job of 10 lakh per annum. I will get, the bank says, I will get 15% of whatever you are earning. You are my capital, you are my asset. Whatever you are earning, I'll get a percentage out of it. 15% means, 10% means 1 lakh, 15% 1 lakh 50,000. So every year I want 1 lakh 50,000 for the next, let's say, 15 years. This is what it says. Let's say after 2 years, my income increases to 20 lakh. Okay, I get a promotion, my income increases to 20 lakh. I will still need 15%, so 3 lakh. It will increase, it will keep increasing as your income increases. Let's say there is another child who goes to the to an MBA college, he gets no job. Or he gets a job of only, let's say, 1 lakh per annum, does not get placed very well. I still get 15% of whatever he earns, so the bank is in a loss now. The bank ends up getting only 15,000 as his return per annum. So there is a high risk involved and there is a high return also involved. This is called as a human capital contract. There are both advantages of and disadvantages of human capital contract, which are mentioned here. Okay. Next one, financial dualism. Coexistence of organized and unorganized sector. What is the organized sector? All the regulatory agencies, all the scheduled commercial banks, all the regional rural banks, all the different kinds of banks, all those are all the NBFCs which are registered with RBI. Okay, these are all part of organized sector. And then there is an unorganized sector. Unorganized sector, which means money lenders, which means merchants in the market, which lend you in the informal market. All these are all the companies which are fraudulent in nature, which lend you money and then they ask for a lot more. Like we had the Sahara scam. I hope you remember that and you understand that. Okay. So if there is an organized market and there is an unorganized market, the coexistence of it is called as financial dualism. The objective of every economy is to reduce the intensity or depth of unorganized market. Microfinance institutions, what are these? These are just like banks, but the only difference is they lend small amount of loans to extremely poor people. Let's say I'm a rickshaw wala and I want a loan to buy a new rickshaw. 10,000 rupees I only want. Okay, I don't want a loan of 10 lakh. I only want a loan of 10,000 rupees. Every month I will pay you 1,000 rupees, or every month I will pay you, let's say, 500 rupees I will pay you every month. So in 20 months, I will pay you the entire principal plus some interest also I will pay. Okay, so every month I'm paying you 500 rupees. So this is a very small loan amount given to extremely poor people. and these institutions which provide these small loans to the unorganized sector, to people who do not have any guarantee. I explained guaranteed banking, who do not have any guarantee, who do not have any cards or any kind of certificates which can prove that they will be able to pay back, who do not have any credibility in the market. Lending to these kind of people is what microfinance institutions do. It was originated in Bangladesh. Self-help groups. Self-help groups are very strongly connected with microfinance institutions. Let me explain it here only. Okay, today there is only one rickshawala. Let us take it there. Today there is only one rickshawala. Okay, let's say 10 rickshawalas come together and then they say, let's form a self-help group. Let's say we will deposit from every one of you. You already have rickshaws. From every one of you, we will take a deposit of 100 every month. 100 every month we have taken, 10 people, 1000 we have. Okay. Now this 1000 we will use for the benefit of one of these 10 in every month, just like a kitty that we have. And because these self-help groups are created, now all these 10 people are accountable to one another. So now let's say they say, okay, instead of normal rickshaws, let's have those battery rickshaws. Okay, let's improve our lives, let's have battery rickshaws. But then they identify, we don't have the money. Every battery rickshaw costs 50,000 rupees. We need a loan of total of 5 lakh rupees. They go to a microfinance institution and then say, sir, we are a group of 10 people who are responsible to each other and we need a loan of 5 lakh rupees in order to purchase this battery rickshaws, 10 battery rickshaws. Microfinance institution says, okay, I will give you 5 lakh. I need this. Let's say I need 5,000 rupees of installment every month. Okay, 5,000, 10 people means 500 every person, 500 per person. Okay, 9 people pay, 4,500 is received in the first month. One person does not pay. He says, I don't have the money. He's a little badmash. He says, I don't have the money. Okay. Then these 10 people, these remaining 9 people pressurize him. They tell him, because of you, we are going to lose our rickshaws. Because if we don't pay, this institution will pick up our rickshaws. We'll take our rickshaws away and we will not have any life. So now he's pressurized. And this 10th person, who was a little cruel, badmash, who did not want to pay, also is pressurized to pay. Okay, so this way they end up, all of them end up paying the money. Then we have refinance. So what is the meaning of refinance? Let us understand. Refinance, the name itself says you want to finance it again. Let's say you are a child and you go to a bank and you take an educational loan. Let's say you take an educational loan of 25 lakh. Okay, now there is a moratorium of five years. So after 5 years, you have to start paying. After 2 years, you get a job of, let's say the package is very good. You get a job of 50 lakh per annum. It's a very good job that you've received. You've got a very well placed. You want to pay back your loan. The bank says, okay, we do not have that facility here. We cannot allow you to pay back faster. Although now it is not an option, but let's say the bank says, okay, you cannot pay back faster because it is not possible. It is there in the agreement. So let's close this and open another loan. Let's say open another loan where you can pay back faster. So they create another loan where the provision of paying back faster is possible. You pay, let's say, 10 lakh in the first year and 15 lakh in the second year. And now only in 4 years you are rid of your loan. 2 years of your education and 2 years of your principal payments. Okay. Now there's another situation. This is a positive situation. There can also be a negative situation. The child says, even after 5 years, he says, I have not received any job. I cannot pay back the loan. I don't know what to do. The bank says, okay, let's refinance it because we don't want you to go into NPA. So let's refinance it. After five years, the bank says, okay, I will give you another moratorium of 2 years and I will reduce your interest rate from 9% to 8% and I will increase your time period of your loan. It was 10 years before. Now let me increase it to 15 years so that you pay less per year. Okay. So this way the bank has refinanced by paying, by changing the conditions and creating another loan. That loan is closed by the bank, paid by itself, and then another loan is opened by the bank. Okay, so this is called as refinancing. It says existing loan with a new loan that pays off the debt of the old loan. The new loan should have better terms or features that improve your finances. Okay. The next is Kisan Credit Card. Very simple. It was launched in 1998. What is the purpose of Kisan Credit Card? Let's say you are a farmer and you start, sowing the seeds of Rabi crop, let's say wheat, in October. So you start sowing the seeds in October. From October, Lodi happens, let's say in January. From October to January, you don't have any income. You start sowing the seeds in October, but between October and January, there is no income at all. One second. Okay, between October and January, there is no income at all. So October, November, December, January. 4 months, you're not earning anything. And at the end of 4 months, you suddenly get, because you are able to sell off your entire crop, you suddenly get, let's say, 10 lakh rupees. So October, November, December and January, you have not earned anything. But at the end of January, you suddenly get, you sell off all your crop and you get 10 lakh rupees. Okay. So Kisan Credit Card says, okay, we will give you, let's say you need a loan of 1 lakh rupees or you need 1 lakh rupees in order to sow these crops and to survive for these 4 months. So farmer says, I need 1 lakh rupees as loan in order to sow, in order to take care of these crops for the 4 months, in order to feed my family. And at the end of 4 months, I will receive all this money and I'll pay back this entire loan. So Kisan Credit Card is like a debit card which is provided to a farmer, and the loan amount of 1 lakh is available there in this example, and the farmer can take out that money whenever he wants. Okay, as and when, let's say today I want 1000 rupees, I take out 1000 rupees only. I do not have to go to the bank in order to take out the money, and I don't have to take the permission of the bank also every time I need this money. Okay, so this is called Kisan Credit Card. NRE and NRO account, I think it's the last one and it's the most important one. The full form is NRE is non-resident external rupee account, and NRO is non-resident ordinary rupee account. Understand and remember the full form first and then we'll move forward. Non-resident ordinary rupee account and non-resident external rupee account. Okay. So now we have understood the names ordinary and external. How are they different from each other and what is the purpose? The purpose of both these accounts is very similar. It is to manage incomes of NRIs. The difference is, for NRE account, you can only deposit money which has been earned outside India. Let's say I am living in the US and every month I want to remit, let's say, 10,000 rupees to my parents for their expenses. Now, whatever I'm earning in the US, I can deposit that in an NRE account in rupees, and then my parents can take it out. Okay. The condition is money should be earned outside India. And then you have non-resident ordinary rupee account, in which, let's say, I have a house in Delhi and I've given it on rent and I'm receiving, let's say, 20,000 per month. So at the end of the year, I receive 2,40,000. So all that money, 2,40,000, cannot go into a saving account. Why? Because I'm an NRI. NRIs are not allowed to have saving account in India in their name. They have to open an NRO account, non-resident ordinary rupee account, and in that account, their money will go. That money can now be transferred to their account in the US if they want to. That is the flexibility that we have. So NRO is for income earned in India, and NRE is for income earned outside India by NRIs, which they want somehow to be used in India. That is the main difference. But both these accounts are for NRIs and persons of Indian origin. I hope you have understood what are NREs and NROs. Okay, so this was the last one. I hope you like this session. In this session, we discussed some very interesting, important terms. In the next session, again, I'll be picking up more important terms. Till that time, all the very best. Take care. Have a nice day.